So I'm going to talk about tipping points in lemur evolution and conservation. Tipping points is basically, I think it's a concept that has evolved or being used in social sciences and in economics. And basically what it means that there must be some critical points when small changes can really make a big difference. Like you can study a system like water from minus 50 degrees below to 32 degrees Fahrenheit above and nothing changes. And then you just increase by 1 degree and you get a mess in your hand. So that's basically what tipping points mean. And in principle, that's this old concept from Anne and Paul Ehrlich's rivet popper hypothesis. If you remember, they postulated that if you have an airplane, you can take out any number of rivets until you eventually come to the one that you shouldn't have taken out. And then the whole thing just collapses. And this concept has become a major buzzword at least for German funding agencies. And I think for two reasons. One reason might be that people think it will be very, very difficult to turn the tide of biodiversity loss and habitat destruction if we follow some kind of continuum. And they think it would be much more effective to identify this type of tipping points if they existed, where you can address a very specific point in space and time and have a much broader, much higher impact than working over a very, very large scale. The other issue might be that it certainly would require much less money if you only had to address a very small issue. So these tipping points can be important for us, for ecologists also, for the questions how degraded a forest can actually be and still maintain the original lemur community. Or if you just turn the argument around, how much restoration do we have to put into a place to make it look like a forest and to be acceptable for a lemur species? Then also, what's also important is how much forest do we actually need to maintain connectivity between habitats? And then finally, actually, what makes a forest a forest? So these are issues that are relevant for conservation, for restoration, I think for biogeographic evolution, and possibly also for climate change effects if we have enough forest left in Madagascar to study climate change effects in a couple of years. And now, so the question is, where should we study something like this? And I think that's a very major problem we have been facing over the last couple of, well, basically forever. Because what we do is if we go somewhere, we study the animals where the animals are. And we study them where they occur in very high densities because we need sample sizes, we need to see the animals, we need to find the animals. But you know, we won't be able to see a very big difference whether we work here or whether we work here along this environmental dimension. It's just our response variables in most cases are just not sensitive enough to measure anything. But what we would be able to do is we would be able to see a change between here and here. So what I think we should do is we should go out and study our animals where they are no longer or where they cannot survive. And this is what I've been doing for the last 20 years. It's a bit frustrating because you don't see animals. But I hope I don't know whether we learned anything, but we tried at least. So the first question is, how much forest does a forest species actually need to make a living? And we studied this in the southwestern part of Madagascar because we thought, well, we need to go to an area that really represents a limit. And the southwest might be one of the places to go to study this. But you see here, that's Tsimun and Petsutz National Park. It's a, well, spiny forest. And what you also see is that that's the national park. As you go to the boundaries, you get clearings, you get tawi, you get just a degraded forest, and then eventually you have agriculture on both sides of the forest. And in a more schematic view, this is what we have been doing. So the national park is here, basically, and then we ran a transect or several transects from the national park down to the coast. And just to illustrate how this looks like in reality, So that's what our forests look like with beautiful baobabs. I call our forest, well, it's not my forest, but it feels like my forest. And these baobabs are, we know now, are 1,200 years old, so that's a pretty old tree there. And then as you go from the park towards the coast, you get degradation, you get people coming in, you have cattle come in, you have people coming in, taking out trees and wood, and then you get more cattle, you get less trees, eventually you end up in agricultural area. And what's very, very important is this setup is what you see here. These little green lines, these are hedges around fields. And these hedges have proven to be very, very essential connectivity elements to maintain biodiversity in the region. And then eventually, when you get to the coast, you end up in something scrubby like this. And then what you need next is you need a graduate student, and you have to convince him or her that it's a great idea to work in this area and to run transects through these scrubby, spiny stuff. Eventually, you find somebody, you can always tell people, well, in the former times, we always did this, and it was great fun. And but eventually it works and somebody does it. And so we had Kim Stephens doing and surveying mouse lemurs in this area. And just to make a long story short, he found these animals in all the places where you have these pluses. And but there were some areas, some places where they didn't occur anymore. It's marked by the minus signs here. And if you do this, if you transfer this into a more formalized quantitative way, to run logistic regressions on this, you find that you have a very, very precise threshold when these animals start dropping out. It's not a very broad range what they can use and what they cannot use anymore, but it's a very sharp line. And the only thing I could say is that he should have taken more samples here, basically in the open, but then who goes out in fields and measures tree densities where there are no trees. So the statistical significance could be increased tremendously by sampling these open areas, but this doesn't really matter. What's important is there are these thresholds and animals respond to them very, very precisely. So if we have more of those, and so that's just an example again about for mouse lemurs, we can also then quantify how many food trees these animals need to be able to make a living. And that's a good thing about these spiny forests. You know each tree personally because there are so few of them. And you can really measure them, and you can map them, and you can count them. And what you find out is eventually that below a certain threshold, well, that's somewhere there. I don't see the pointer anymore. But below a certain threshold of tree densities, the animals just do not find enough to eat to make a living anymore. So and the home range size they would need would increase exponentially, and so it simply doesn't pay off to use these areas anymore. Certainly, we only measured food trees here. If you have microcephes that catches one of these hissing cockroaches that is as big as itself, it certainly blurs and increases variability of your measure, but still there is this cutoff point. And we have the same cutoff point for other species like these Galadictis. They occur in large numbers in the area, but only in areas that are at the maximum of 5 to 6 kilometers close to water. And again, because Anne wrote in one of her first mails that we should talk about lemurs and beyond, and I think I'm going more towards the beyond part. Again, we also have for reptiles, we find the same thresholds or very similar thresholds. Again, you have a high or an unchanging number of reptile species in an area up to a threshold about 30 to 40% of tree cover, and then the communities basically collapse. So the question then is, what must the forest actually deliver to maintain a lemur species? Again, Zimmermann Pitsütz, and now again, this the national park here, that's the forested part here. And if you look at the distribution of Propithecus, Lepilema, and Microcebus, and our species distribution models are not as sophisticated as the ones we have just heard about. But what we find is that We have some, again, very precise and very sharp limit of the distribution of these species in this forest. And if I go into the forest, I don't see a difference. I don't see a difference between north and south, but these animals obviously see a difference and respond to it. And the question is, what does this difference make? And now I'm coming back to this seminal paper of Bob Dürer and Alison Richard, and I simply want to illustrate what variability means. Because numbers are one thing, but I think colors can maybe illustrate better what it means. So what we have here is that's a measure of the annual primary production in of the region here. Dark blue are areas that are not very productive. Green and yellow are very productive areas. And so we have data from 2000 to 2015. And if you just look at the variability, it's, I find it amazing. You can have an area where you have basically very, very low productivity in one year, but very high productivity the next year. And it's not just this extremely high change between years. And if you look at the scale also, that's a difference between the dark blue and the yellow of about 30%. So a 30% change in or difference in productivity is quite a lot. But you don't only have this variability all between years, but also just between regions. It takes a couple of kilometers and you have a completely different situation than where you used to be before. So that's the annual primary production. What I found even more interesting is the month of the maximum production. We have it's a very seasonal area, and we normally have rain in December, January, and February. And that's what you see here in this picture here. That's what you would expect, that during the rainy season you have the highest productivity. But then you go 3 years down the road, and it's reverse. It's in the dry season. Actually, it's in May, June, and July when you have the highest productivity. And if you then go further on, if you look at 2010 here, you have an area that's about 30 to 40 kilometers. And in one area, you have the highest productivity in July, and 40 kilometers further east, it's in December. And now imagine you are a lemur, and you have to make a living in this area, and you have to just find some kind of way to cope with all this variability. That's a real challenge, and we have no idea how these animals actually do it, especially the short-lived animals, because if you are dead in 1 year, it doesn't matter if the next year is good. So if we come back to the limits of our lemur distributions here of the Propithecus, Lepilemur, and a different species of Microcebus, then what we think we can see, well, the sign of heaven, you don't see anything, is that the northern part looks a bit different than the southern part in terms of color. And if you quantify this again, we can, well, nail it down, compare the northern section to a southern section, and we see in the north has more, a higher productivity, the south has higher productivity than the north. There would be all kinds of variables we could pull out, see a difference there. The question really is whether that's really relevant. You can also check at the variability. Again, the variability in the north is much higher than it is in the south. But is this actually relevant to these animals, and how do they cope with them? Now, first, can they cope with this type of variation? If you look at at radiated tortoises here, these animals lay eggs between March and September. So that's 6 months. And then the young hatch within 7 days in December in the wild, and within 4 weeks if you keep these animals in captivity. So that's, for me, that's a very stunning question on how do these animals do this? How does an egg that's deposited in the ground in March knows probably somewhere in October, now I should start developing? But that's a very interesting, I think, very interesting question. And I have the impression that some of our mouse lemurs do the same thing. So photo period for them is not, I think it's not relevant. It might trigger something, but it does not determine reproduction. If you look at trees now, at tree reproduction, that's also a question that always has been, what really makes a tree flower? What determines the phenology of the Malgash forests? So what we did here is we ran a transect again in southern Madagascar, now in this case from Tsimonabitsuts to Andohahela, which is on the other side of the island. And so we basically get from dry forest here in Tsimonabitsuts to evergreen rainforest in Andohahela here. So we used sites that are more or less at a similar latitude, so we have a very similar photo period, but we have everything else is different. I listed a few things, but there are many, many more. And if you look at the phenology of these data, just have another picture of, because I really like the way the Malgash PhD students draw these forests that you can really have a very hard time taking pictures of. If you look at the phenology of these forests, they are basically identical. So you have peaks in fruit, in flowering, always at the same, in the same months of the year. In a very dry area, you have a couple of plants coming in that have different flowering phenology, and in the very wet area also, but everything else is basically identical. The differences are in the fruiting phenology and in the leaf production. But I couldn't really figure out how to show this here in a way that's comprehensible. But I think that's a way to that needs more study, and Alison pointed this out very nicely yesterday. So, I mean, these are now many, many correlations. We found a lot of plasticity in these radial tortoises. We found basically no plasticity in the flowering phenology. We find a lot of plasticity in fruit production, in leaf production. And at the end, we just don't understand any of this. And the question then really is there any way of really getting a handle on it? And in order to do this, you know this better than I do, we need experiments. And one way that has not been exploited enough, I think, in Madagascar is to use restoration as large-scale experiments. And so we try to do this in collaboration with a mining company, that's the Kit Madagascar Minerals in the southeast of Madagascar, that's in the area of Fortofin. And they are mining titanium-rich sands in the coastal plain. And within this coastal plain, we have a number of littoral forest fragments that are all evergreen forest fragments. And they used to be, when we started the work, that very different degree of forest cover, and we thought, well, okay, there we can really study how much forest you need to be a forest. It turned out, I would like to shorten this a bit, that this didn't work out because the human impact was too high. There was a lot of hunting, there was a lot of charcoal making, and disturbance was too high. So we couldn't really find anything that was interpretable. But what we could do there is we could start establishing corridors between some of these forest fragments. And the first corridors we established, were between these yellow fragments up there. It was a huge effort, and the mining company really put in several of these corridors with precisely described species composition, and it was all wonderful until the charcoal makers came in. And what was very nice is they really respected our corridors, but they didn't respect the forest at either end of the corridor. So after 10 years, we had wonderful corridors, but no forest on either side. So this didn't work either. And then we started different approaches of restoration experiments. What you see here, that's to create, again, buffer zones and to create corridors. What you see here, that's a plantation of 39 native tree species, but that's a plantation after 8 years, and I figured I would need a lot of this famous drug from Easter Island to see the results of this experiment. So we basically gave up on this, and I should point out that all the work there is being done and has been done by the wonderful environmental team of Kit Madagascar Minerals. I think they are probably among the best ecologists we have in Madagascar. Just wonderful people. And so they established two different types of corridors. One you see on the left, the other one you see on the right. The one on the left is composed of exotic tree species, 4 years old, about 8 to 10 meter high. The one on the right is composed of endemic species, also rather diverse forest, but just about a meter to two high. And then we checked when and whether animals could actually use these types of forest. We had another forest that established itself, that's an invasive exotic species that just came in and filled the gap between two of the fragments, so we also used this. And we set up regular trapping grids at equal distances in these different forest fragments, so the black lines indicate the limits of these forest fragments, the white squares or whatever this is, indicate our trapping grids, and we had equal distances between forest and also within forest fragments to see whether we really can assess movements of animals within and between forest fragments. That's another thing that didn't work. So we, because we didn't, in 16 years of, no, 20 years of trapping, we caught 3 microcebus that had moved either within a forest or between forest fragments. So that this approach didn't work, and I would not advise to try it elsewhere. But what worked then is we set up these trapping grids now within the, right on either side of the corridors and within the corridors that had been established, so I didn't say this, these consisted, the red things consist of corridors that had been planted. And then we found that within 3 to 4 years of a corridor consisting of exotic species, we get microcebus going in and moving through. And if these corridors, again, of exotic species are between 15 and 20 years old, we basically get all the other larger lemur species coming in and moving through. The ewe lemurs don't need these corridors, they just move everywhere. And the caragalios don't use any of them, they just stay in there, in the forest fragments. We don't really know yet when these endemic species corridors will become effective. So far they have not been effective. And I think this may be one of the messages I really would like to get across the counter. I know people don't like me for this, but I think we need to think more about reforestation, about buffer zones composed of exotic species. I know that's not politically correct, I think, to say, but the problem I see is that these corridors or the plantations of endemic species, they are just too slow. And it doesn't matter if we have a wonderful forest composed of native species 20 years down the road, if the species are gone next year. So that's why we need both. We cannot just plant one and not the other, we need both. But I think these exotic species, tree species, have some potential that are not exploited to the extent we should do it. And with this, I would like to stop. I would like to thank you all. I didn't dare to thank anybody individually because I was sure I would forget half of you. So I just say thank you to the community of lemurologists. But somebody I really would like to thank is, that's Alison Jolly. I think none of us probably would be here without her impact and without her having paved the road for all of us in Madagascar and also in the public. And also I would like to point out that Preston Burgess is here today, one of the first companions of Alison when she first went to Madagascar and set up the study in Berente. Thank you.